brethren. My name is Dan Luddick, and this is another study in a series of studies that I felt led to bring to the body because of the errors that are out there in this end time situation that we find ourselves in. I think everybody understands that the church isn't in a perfect place, and our doctrines aren't in a perfect place. It's something that we just have to know and accept and believe that God would bring a correction. He's brought correction to me and things that I've believed in the past, things that I thought for sure were the Word of God until I started to actually study and fast and pray about what I was reading. And God opened up His Word to me through many resources. I just tell you, you know, I've sat under the fivefold ministry. I've sat under prophets and apostles and people that have had the anointings in the fivefold ministry, and it says that God gave that to the church. And I've had hands laid on me. I've had words prophesied over me that God would open up the Word to me, and that certain hard sayings would become easy for me to understand, and that He would put all the pieces of the puzzle together that I would see and comprehend with all the saints what is the length and breadth and depth and height. You know, I'm not saying that to brag. I'm just trying to give you an understanding of who I am and where I've been, because it says we're supposed to know those that labor among us. So just giving you a little info there. You can do with that what you choose. But like anything, like anybody, you're a pastor, another brother in the Lord, anybody shares with you anything, you are supposed to take it to God. That inner witness of the Spirit should speak to you and say yay or nay. And there should be peace. And there should be understanding. I know a lot of things that I was deceived in. There really wasn't an understanding other than what somebody was saying to me. And because I hadn't checked the Word out, I had nothing to balance what they were saying with. And so I just agreed with them. You know, be it rapture, be it once saved, always saved. You know, it more fell in line with my soul, and that's why I fell in lockstep with it and believed it. But these things aren't so, brethren. A lot of them aren't so, and that's why we're supposed to diligently seek the Word. So this study is going to be on what's called plurality in the church. It's the way God has ordained for His church to truly function in the earth. And of course, like everything, Satan has set up a counterfeit to it, and he's trying to, of course, in all things, weaken the church, take away our power, bring us into a place where the Holy Spirit really can't flow to us to defeat him in this earth, to destroy the works of Satan. So he's more cunning than any creature. He's more intelligent than any Einstein there would ever be on this planet. He knows many, many things, but not all. And you see, the one thing he can't understand is that he does get defeated. We see that in Revelation. We see that This fallen creature does end up in the lake of fire because of his pride, because of his arrogance, because of his inability and his refusal to repent and submit unto the living God. And that is something I don't ever want levied on me, and I would hope not you either. So let's get started in the study. You know, like I was saying, if the church were to ever truly move as one, you know, with all the checks and balances and in the function that God tells us to function in, Satan would be a goner. He wouldn't last very long in this earth, but this is why he's still been around, and we see ourselves at the very end of the sixth millennium now. And we know it's not the seventh millennium because the judgment seat of Christ hasn't come forth. The thousand-year reign hasn't started. Satan hasn't been bound yet, obviously. So no matter what secular calendars say, we're not in the seventh millennium, brother. And I hope that's not too big of a shock to too many of you, but we have to go by what God's Word says, not by what secular man has connived and intellectually derived from things that he knows not of. You know, the Dark Ages, things stopped. You know, they don't know what day we're actually in. They know that even the best secular scientist who studies calendars and times will tell you we're 4 to 8 years off on our calendar, even now, even with leap years and everything. So that's what that is. But anyway, Jesus ordained a fivefold ministry when he came to this earth. It speaks in Romans, speaks in Ephesians about that God gave some apostles, prophets, evangelists, shepherds and teachers. Okay, it's not pastors, it should be shepherds. And for the work of the ministry to edify the saints, to bring us into the unity, to bring us into one man up into Christ. So that's called a fivefold ministry. It's represented by our hand. Okay, that's one way to remember the fivefold ministry. But what's happened, and that ministry, it's a horizontal submission. It's submitting one to another. It's the toe can't saying to the foot, I have no need of you. It can't say that. Each part has a, you know, it says when we come together, we each have a song or a hymn or an exhortation or an interpretation or a tongue. There's all these gifts God's given to his body, and they're all supposed to flow by the Spirit when we come together. But that isn't what happens in Christianity nowadays, especially within denominational churches. And speaking of denominational churches, what is operating? I'll try and explain this as plainly as I can. What's operating right now is not a fivefold ministry, okay? Even when people believe in the fivefold ministry, those fellowships that I've seen operate in it, they still start to move in the Spirit I'm going to talk about, and God says he hates it. And what this is it's a clergy-laity structure where you have a class of Christians who consider themselves the clergy. They're the pastor, there's the master, they're the fathers, they're the whatever. I mean, it's even within outside of Christianity, the imams and the Buddhas, all these, they assume these titles onto themselves. They place themselves up higher than the rest of the brethren around them. And they want to be seen in that place. I mean, they desire that. They put name tags on their doors. Pastor so-and-so, assistant pastor so-and-so. You know, this, that. I've been in places where they come up and they say, hello, brother, I'm prophet so-and-so. It's sickening. It's just the arrogance he just oozes out of those statements. And the fact that they can't even see that, it's a sad testimony. But what this is so this clergy-laity structure has come. It's come from Nimrod. We'll talk about that. But it's based on like the priesthood, and that, you know, the Old Testament, the priests, and they, you know, the Book of Leviticus, all the stuff that God had established back then. Okay, well, what happened was that was under the law, and God was trying to prove man cannot be perfected under a law. He's going to show even under grace man can't be perfected. And then he binds Satan, and during the seventh millennium, he starts to bring people into the fullness, but we know even at the end of that, their sin is as the sand of the sea. So God is trying to prove his infinite manifold wisdom to everybody, to spirits, to us, to Satan, you know. And so when Jesus came and when he died on the cross, when he fulfilled, you know, he became that great sacrifice that was offered once for the remission of all of our sins. He did away with the Levitical priesthood, okay? The Jews, everybody, the Gentiles, they should realize now that we are not to operate in a priesthood. That was abolished. Jesus became our high priest, our one and only high priest. And now what he says you move under is this fivefold. The apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, the teachers, you know, that is what he's given to perfect his body and to bring us into the unity of the faith. Okay? So, no more priesthood. You're going to have a hard time telling that to the Roman Catholics. Okay? They didn't make the jump. Okay? They're still stuck on that baby. And this was replaced again in Ephesians 4 and 1 Corinthians 12. And it's supposed to bring a unity and a plurality and a smitting one to another. So there is an even keel, there's a plank, that there isn't this hierarchy, okay? And we'll get into that, okay? But what's happened is this fivefold ministry has become a stumbling stone for most churches, most denominations. And I'm talking even within Protestant churches, okay? And what it is most Christians, what they want is they want one man to push into God. So they don't have to. They will call this man pastor, whatever he wants to be called, father this, pastor that, reverend this. They don't care, just so they don't have to push into God that hard. Okay? This other man will, and they want that guy to tell them what God said. And We're going to see that coming up. This was what happened with Moses way back then. And it's been going on ever since. But let's look at this. You know, I read you what it was in Ephesians 4:11. I think most all Christians have heard that verse about, you know, how God gave some apostles. So I'm not going to read that again. But this is 1 Corinthians 12:14-20. For the body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, because I am not of the hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the ear shall say, because I am not of the eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body
were an eye,
where would the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where were the smelling? But now has God set the members, every one of them in his body, as it has pleased him. And if they were all one member, where were the body? But now are they many members, but yet one body. And that's 1 Corinthians 12 there. And well, let's just go right in here and keep reading here in 1 Corinthians 12. This is 27 through 21. Now ye are the body of Christ, and members in particular. And God has set some in the church, first apostles, secondary prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, then the gifts of healings, helps, governments, diversities of tongues, are all apostles. And I want you to realize it didn't even mention shepherds or pastors. That's put in the King James, okay? Didn't even mention them in that list. Not that they're not there, but they weren't even mentioned as chronologically, it seems like, in order of priority there. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Are all workers of miracles? Have all the gifts of healings? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? But covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way. So you see, even this fivefold ministry is going to be replaced. There is a more excellent way coming. It's called the high calling. Paul said, I press on towards the mark of the high calling. And you're going to find out that's in Christ Jesus. Praise God. Okay, so let's read this in 1 Peter now. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves to the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another. Now there's that plurality. And be clothed with humility. For God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. That's 1 Peter 5:5. Okay? But Christians still desperately seek to control their lives. And this is the battle that goes on between the spirit and the flesh. You know, and I'll tell you what, this spirit of control that these leaders like to have. I mean, that's why they're in that position. If God didn't appoint them, if he truly didn't appoint them, he struggles with, sometimes there's a struggle with the ones he has appointed with dealing with this, but there's a lot of people out there God did not appoint. They appointed themselves. It talks about appointing elders for yourselves, you know, that they prayed and fast, and like Timothy and different ones. They appoint the elders, and there's qualifications. They have to rule over their house good, you know, says to be of one wife. And I won't go into that, but it's one wife at a time, because some people have been divorced. Their wives have cheated on them, you know, and divorced them. And anybody who's pressing into God, God doesn't hold that on their head. But that's another thing. But so you appoint people like that, but God gave these fivefold ministry. He appoints them. But everyone else, it seems, if they're in that place, they love the spirit of control. And what runs with that spirit is this respect of person spirit. And you're going to see how that is, it forms this pyramid. I've talked about this a lot in my other teachings, but I think we're going to get into that. If I don't find it, I'll share it. But okay, now this spirit of control and this respect of persons, you're going to see this manifest in the churches today, and it's been going on for a while. It's when people take on in themselves titles, okay? Titles and things like I talked about, you know, Pastor so-and-so, Reverend so-and-so, Father so-and-so, Doctor so-and-so, okay? This is Doctor so-and-so-and-so. I almost said a name there because it's so common to hear it on the TV, but I'm not going to name names here. You know who they are, you know. And when you say a doctor, you're meaning they're a doctor of divinity. It means they're a master, okay? A master of God's word. That's what that doctor title means. And yet, Jesus said, we're not supposed to be called master, rabbi, and all these things, okay? So You gotta see, people, the church goes directly against the word of God and they haven't even a clue they're doing it. Let's read this though about this one, Reverend so-and-so. I'm sure you've all heard Reverend so-and-so, okay? This is Reverend so-and-so. Bad title to take on to yourself. It says, he sent redemption onto his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and reverend is his name. Now this is Psalms 111, verse 9. Okay, it's talking about God. Holy and reverend is his name. And yet men take that title upon themselves. And you're going to find out about this, what that's called. Okay, it's names of blasphemy. Okay, now I hear Protestants saying all the time, look at those stupid Catholics. Don't they know the priesthood has ended yet? You know, and yet most of these churches, the Protestant churches, they throw out everything from the fivefold ministry. There's a lot of churches. They have nothing to do with so-called apostles. They have prophets. What's that? You know, they know they'll believe in evangelists and the pastor. Okay, they'll move with that and teachers. But they throw out the power gifts. Okay, if you start talking in tongues in a lot of these churches, they're going to say you're of the devil. And the Bible talks about blaspheming the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit. I'd be a little afraid of saying that. Okay, so what they have in these churches, and they mock the Catholic Church and say the stupid Catholics. They got this priest up front and all these clergy, your laity class, just sit there and don't they know that's ended? They turn right around and there's a pastor up front and there's all the people in the pews and it never changes. It's really hard to bring a check and balance in the midst of that situation because it's not there. Yeah, you can schedule a meeting with the pastor and go in and talk to him and you know what? You get kicked out of the church because I've like gone through that twice. So there's no real check and balance. There's no real submitting one to another. And I'll say that's just for the majority. I'll never say that's for everybody because I'm sure there are some sincere, honest, God-seeking pastors out there that, you know, that's just what they know to operate in now. So that's how they move because they want to serve God. So I'm not coming against this. There is a ministry of the shepherd. It's not pastor, it's shepherd because there's definitions of what a shepherd does. The good shepherd goes before his flock, okay? There's things that it tells you what a shepherd should do. But, so, God teaches a balance in a submitting one to another in his word. We've read these verses. There's a submitting one to another. It has to be that way. But what man has done is we'll get to that. We'll get to this pyramid structure that's actually out there. Okay, so let's read this in Matthew 15. Then came his disciples and said unto him, knowest thou that the Pharisees were offended after they heard this saying? But he, Jesus, answered and said, every plant which my Father has not planted shall be rooted up. Let them alone. They be blind leaders of the blind. And if the blind lead the blind, both shall fall into the ditch. You see, this is why things are off. If God hasn't appointed them, okay, and if they're moving in a structure that's outside of the will of God, there's going to be much error, much deception, and much loss because of that in the house of God. Okay? Satan works hard to keep the proper order out of God's church. He knows that. It's just like an army. You want to destroy an army, you start to work on its infrastructure. It's not always going to be on the battlefield head to head. You want to destroy it before you ever get to that point. You want to weaken it, corrupt it, whatever you have to do, poison it. Okay? Then there's no battle to fight. Okay. So with Satan, it's like it's easier for him to deceive one person or a few or leaders of a church or a denomination or a fellowship than it is to take out a functioning fivefold body, because he can't do it. He knows if the church moves in what God says, it cannot be defeated. Just like in the Old Testament, when the Israelites, when they moved in God's order, they never lost a battle. But when they moved outside of God's order, God didn't show up and they lost. Okay, it's happened all the time. So what it is when Christians call themselves Reverend so-and-so, when they call themselves Father so-and-so, or even Doctor so-and-so, what they're doing is they're taking on names of blasphemy that were intended for God alone, okay? Were names that God told them not to take. So And I'll just read part of this here because we're going to read it later, but it says in Revelation 17, "So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast full of the names of blasphemy." And we're going to get into who this woman is, and we're trying to talk to you right now what these names of blasphemy are, and we'll talk to you about what this beast is, a scarlet-colored beast. Okay, so this system, it's a pyramid structure system, and it came out of Babylon, okay? It's a religious cultic religion that was founded by Nimrod. And there's this book called Two Babylons, and it's by Alexander Hislop. And right now, if you try and buy that, it's a corrupted version. The Catholic Church actually got in and altered that book. The version I have was copyrighted in 19, or second printing was 1959. And it still got the meat and the guts of what was brought forth. And this man, this Hislop, Alexander Hislop, he really goes back into investigating and showing historically, right from Nimrod, how this ancient cultic pagan religion started to develop and started to infect the world, you know, and it came all the way up into Rome, okay? And governments even structured their governments off of this system. And basically what it is it's a pyramid. Pyramid system with one man at the top. Okay, back in the day it was Nimrod. Okay, he defended the people in the cities. He was a mighty hunter, and they all started to gather in cities, and he would defend them. Of course, he was top dog then, and they all had to do and listen to what he said. And that works out for a while until what he starts to say ain't good. And that's what happens with any of these systems. Jim Jones, any of these people, you know, you start following one man, and he starts getting crazy. Guess what's going to happen to everyone else? So this system, I used the Roman Catholic Church. I was a Catholic for 27 years, so I know it well. So I just use it because it's the easiest to see. But you got this guy at the top, and he's the Pope. They call him the Vicar of Christ, okay? Christ on earth. And then under him are cardinals. And then under him are bishops. And then under them are, you know, priests and deacons. And it's a pyramid. It's a power structure. And this guy's got the most power, and then he delegates it down, and they delegate it out. You know, our militaries, everybody uses this, okay? But it's, what happens is, then all Satan has to do is control the one guy at the top and get him off. And then everybody else underneath that is infected, and they're destroyed, they're taken out, they're neutered, whatever you want to call it. They don't have the power they should have. So, what did Jesus teach when he came? Exactly the opposite. He was God on earth. And he washed the disciples' feet, and he said, "He among you who wishes to be greatest, let him become the least, and you should prefer others above yourself." So you see, he preached an inverted pyramid. But man, of course, has twisted that all around, and we take this Pope, okay, I'll use that again for example. We carry him through the crowds. People are kissing his feet. They kiss his ring, okay? They worship him as God. They worship him as Christ on earth. That's what his title says. And yet the Holy Spirit is supposed to be in each of us who have called on the name of the Lord, who have accepted the blood to deliver us from our sins and redeem us back onto God, okay? We're all saints when we're in that situation. But the Catholic Church, oh, only certain people are saints, and we have to have meetings and decide if they did miracles. And it's a respect of person system. It's horrible. God hates it. You're going to find out. So that's where that came from. And this is what I'm trying to show you, is this plurality in the church and why it's not there. And I'm trying to show you the thing that's off, which is that whole structure that came out of Nimrod, that clergy-laity structure, and versus the fivefold, okay? And this is the difference I want you to see in what's functioning right now, okay? You say, well, we've got a pastor, and no, he don't submit, okay? He might submit to a board it's like a CEO, it's run like a business, okay? It isn't what happens. You can't stand up at a meeting and say, "Brother, I feel the Lord's moving on me. I'd like to come up and speak a word." Yeah. What are you talking about? Ushers, throw that man out right now. I mean, that's what would go on. I've seen it. I've been there. Okay? You go to a Baptist church and try that and see what happens to you. Oh, my gosh. So, anyway, now here's this thing back in Exodus. And I said the heart of why this works so good, why Satan can pull this over so many Christians, is because of their weakness in their own soul. Yeah, they get saved, And then God starts to talk about that they need to come into a place of sanctification. They need to grow. They need to be changed. And that process is hard because it talks about Jesus having to lay the axe to the root. And it talks about fasting, and it talks about setting yourself aside. All the meat and you know, the hard stuff of Christianity that you don't always hear when you people are first telling you to get saved and telling you how easy it is to just call on the name of the Lord and you'll be saved. And that's true. But then there's another step, and there's another step. And it ends in a fiery furnace, okay, brethren? But you don't hear that when you first come to the Lord. But I'm telling you. So that's why things are getting off. So this is what happened back in Exodus with Moses and the people. And it says, and all the people, and what it was Moses was told by God, gather the people, tell them sanctify themselves, to, you know, come up to the mountain, and we're going to talk, okay? God wanted to prove something to them. So, and all the people saw the thunderings and the lightnings and the noise of the trumpet and the mountain smoking. And when the people saw it, they removed and stood afar off. And they said unto Moses, speak thou with us, and we will hear. But let not God speak with us, lest we die. Okay? And Moses said unto the people, fear not, for God is come to prove you, and that his fear may be before your faces, that you sin not. And the people stood afar off, and Moses drew near unto the thick darkness where God was. That's Exodus 20, 18 through 21. So there's that spirit where God is awesome. You know, who among us has seen him? Who among us has walked in the place Moses did? Okay? It says his hair changed, his countenance so changed when he had to put a bag over his face because the people couldn't stand to be around him just because of the Shekinah glory that was still on Moses when he had come down from the presence of God. But God wanted the people to come into that place where they would come and they would start to see the awesomeness of God and fear and respect and move in obedience. And they didn't want it. They said, you do it. You go to God. You do whatever. And you just tell us what God says and we'll do it. So you see, that same spirit still, that's why the one man ministries work so good. The pastor and the people and the priests and the people, okay? It's wrong. It's not good. Okay, so there's this thing in Revelation 12 that God says he hates, and it's called the doctrine of the Nicolaites. And it says here, so thou hast them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaites, which thing I hate. Revelation 2:15. And if you look up what Nicolaites means in the Greek, it basically means to rule the people. And it says here, victorious over the people, Nicholas, a heretic, Nicholas, and it says that the Nicolaitans love to rule the people. And again, as I said, these people, they love positions of power. They love positions of leadership. I myself despise it because of the responsibility that's involved. And I honestly, I don't see myself as any model that anybody would want to follow. The only thing I have good in me is Jesus Christ, his Holy Spirit. And that's not always present. So with fear and trembling, I'm even teaching you this because I know I'm going to be judged worse than anyone else, it says. And you can look that verse up. But so God says he hates this practice where people rule over other people. And the reason they're doing it is because they love it. They love to have power. They love to be in control. Again, where's that nature coming from? It's right from the pit of hell. What did Satan say in, what was that in Isaiah 14 or I shall sit on the sides of the north. I shall be like the Most High. I shall this, I shall that. The five eyes, you know. The man's full of, he's not a man, he's a creature, you know. He's full of himself. That's what he is. So praise God. So let's read this here in Matthew 20, 25 here. But Jesus called unto them and said, you know that the princes of the Gentiles exercise dominion over them, and they that are great exercise authority upon them. But it shall not be so among you. But whosoever will be great among you, let him be your minister. And that word in the Greek means servant. Okay? And whosoever will be chief among you, let him be your servant. And that word means slave in the Greek. Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister, and to give his life a ransom for many. So there again, there's the bottom of the pyramid, an upside down inverted pyramid. I'm trying to give you a principle that'll make it easier for you to understand when you see that something is off. Because you can get to it. Well, there's a pastor, and it talks about a pastor, and we're all listening, but you got to understand a principle. And then when you see that, you say, well, wait, that isn't what's going on here. That's what I'm hoping you understand. Praise God. It's not that you would tear down a church. It's that it would just start to function the way it should, because God isn't going to bring forth His power in this earth until it does. And I'll show you a verse for that. And that's why the latter rain has not come forth yet, because we're out of order. And God has to bring His church back into order before He's going to bring this rain. And I'll show you it in the Bible. Praise God. Okay, so he says, you know, that these Gentiles, they like to exercise dominion over them, and the great exercise dominion over them. So there's that pyramid structure again. There's different levels of authority, you know. Oh, praise God. Okay. So once again, we see that the world has fallen in lockstep with an ancient Babylonian religion, you know. It's like it says in Ecclesiastic, nothing new is done under the sun. What's been done before will be done again. Satan doesn't have any new tricks in his bag. He just tries to dress it up, make it look a little different. But it's the same stuff coming forth that used to come forth. That's why we need to study history, even in the church. So, again, God created a horizontal unity that we're to have, you know, with Him at the head, okay? This body He created is supposed to have Christ at the head, not a man, not an organization, not a pope, not a pastor, okay? That creates spiritual adultery when you have that as your head, and when you have that as your groom, okay? So, let's see, let's read this verse here in James 4:2. You lust and you have not, you kill and you desire to have, and you cannot obtain. You fight and you war and you have not because you ask not. And that's James 4:2. Okay? This is why God's people are so divided. Okay? There's still a immaturity within our midst. There's still flesh, carnality, whatever. And that's why Satan can so bring this stuff among us, because it's just part of us that God's trying to redeem us from. Remember Zebedee's wife, when she asked for her two sons, who's going to sit on the right and who's going to sit on the left? And what did Jesus say? But Jesus called unto him and said, you know not that the princes of the Gentiles exercise dominion over them, and they that are great exercise authority upon them. Now, you know, we just read this. But it shall not be so among you, okay? And it goes on, and it just talks about that whole principle. Jesus says, no, this is wrong. This disrespect of persons, you know. Well, he's done all this, shouldn't he get that, you know? Everything Jesus preached, he was like, die to yourself. Die to yourself. That's the only way we're going to get filled with the Spirit of God, brethren. It's the only way we're going to get changed. So this lust for power is going to lead the outer court to the false prophet. And you've heard about him in Revelation. And it, you know, it says, this is how the dragon's tail takes out the outer court Christians. We've heard about the tail here. We'll read that. Well, let's read that first here. Okay. This is in Revelation 12. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon having... Now, remember the woman in Revelation 17 is riding on this red beast? Okay, scarlet beast. Okay, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and the 7 crowns upon his heads. And his tail drew a third part of the stars of heaven and it cast them to the earth. Okay, that's Revelation 12 verse 3 and 4. And what that is that beast that has the 7 heads and the 10 horns. Those 10 horns, they're going to go confederate with God. Okay, and it talks about that in Ezekiel 38, these 10 nations are Muslim nations. It gives ancient names for them. Some of them are even like Libya and different ones that are still present today in their same, you know, condition. But what it is talks about Dedan and Seba and Tubal and Meshach, and it gives a list of 10 nations. They're Muslim nations, mostly. And they're going to join up with Gog, who's Russia. I've got this in all my other teachings. I just throwing it out there. You can search this out if you don't believe me. And they attack America. They attack the world. God uses them to bring judgment, okay? this tail ministry. But you, I want to teach you what this tail ministry is. Because Christians are represented in the Bible in typology by stars. Okay? They're called clouds. They're called stars. They're called rocks. They're called a lot of things. But, you know, when God talked to Abraham, he said, your descendants shall be as the stars of heaven. It's the sand of the sea. Okay? And so what this is, you know, we're heavens. We are a body, soul, and spirit. It talks about different heavens. There's a natural heaven. There's the atmosphere, okay? There's the earth as a heaven. It's a planet, okay? Then there's the atmosphere. And then there's the stars. There's all this. There's the natural heavens, okay? Then Paul said, I was caught up to the third heaven. So there's different realms of heaven and the spirit, okay? And so when it talks about the stars of heaven, it's talking about Christians. I'm telling you, brethren, it's talking about the outer court. And this tail that sweeps these stars out of heaven, okay, it brings them down to the earth, it says. It brings them into a carnal realm. It deceives them. That's what I'm telling you right now is going on in the church. All of this denomination, this wrong way in which we are operating under the things of God, it's weakening us. So this dragon's tail that we just read about takes these stars out. But let's read what this tail is. Let the Bible tell you that. Okay, it's in Isaiah 9:15. The ancient and the honorable, he is the head. And the prophet that teaches lies, he is the tail. Okay, so this is why, again, why you let the Bible interpret itself. And this is what it means. It says, the prophet that teaches lies, he's the tail. And so there's people out there that are teaching lies that are, you know, it's not just rapture, it's not just once saved. It's the whole structure and the foundation under which the church is functioning. It's a lie from hell. So praise God. So now let's show you about this this beast in Revelation 13 that has two horns, okay? Because all the symbology in Revelation, it's natural stuff, brethren, but God uses symbolic language to hide things, to keep it hid until the appointed time where he would then release the information of what these things are, okay? This is not monsters and beasts running around. You're carnal if that's what you think this is. So This beast with two horns in Revelation 13:11. These horns, they represent power and authority. You look up horns in the Bible, it's always speaking about power and authority. So you can search that out too, but just believe me for right now. Okay, and it says here, and I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. So, who's the lamb? We know who the Lamb of God was. Is. That's why that's put in here. He had two horns like a lamb. What were the lamb's two horns? Okay, I just told you it represents power and authority. Who's the lamb? The Lamb of God. Well, we know is Jesus. So let's put this together. His two horns were the Spirit and the Word. That was his power in the earth. His Spirit and the Word. The two horns. So you see, this is what this thing is going to come forth like. It's going to have power like a lamb. So it talks about lying signs and wonders, talks about the trying to deceive the very elect if possible, you know. So this person, these people, they're going to have a power, but it's satanic. And we're supposed to know a tree by its fruit. So, but it says that he has two horns like a lamb, but he speaks as a dragon. So there's the big clue that if he's showing you all this power and then he goes, says, kill Christians, guess what? It's from hell. Okay. So it says here that only those who follow the Lamb, wheresoever he goeth, are going to pull free from these harlot churches. Now we're getting into the meat of this study. See, I have to start off nice, but I'm going to start getting into what God calls these churches that are functioning outside of his will. He calls them harlots. He calls them whores. He calls them adulterers. He calls all this verbiage for us to understand how much God hates it. And, you know, I don't know if any of you have been through divorce, I have, but you're going to find out how horrible that situation is. It's bad. So let's read this in Revelation 17. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast, full of the names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. And the woman was arrayed in, now let's see, I told you, women in the Bible are churches. There's a woman church. It's always represented in the Bible from Eve to Hannah to right down the line. There's a woman bringing forth a son, And that son types out and says, and then, you know, Mary bringing forth Jesus. And then Isaiah 66, you know, Zion, that she bears, she travails to bring forth her child. In Revelation 12, the woman brings forth the man child, you know. That's a church. When it talks about a woman, it's a woman church. And there's different levels and realms of these churches in the earth. So this woman is the harlot church. She's the outer court. She's these churches that are functioning under the old Babylon religion. And I'm trying to warn you right now how God sees this. Okay? So, and this woman was arrayed in purple, right? Royalty, priesthood. That comes right out of the Old Testament with the tabernacle and all the colors that were involved in that, the curtains and the gates, okay? And a scarlet colored beast, the red for the scarlet for the blood of Christ, okay? And she was decked with gold. And we know who gold represents, okay? God Almighty, perfect, okay? And precious stones and pearls. And we know in Revelation it talks about these gates of pearls and all this stuff, okay? This is all typology for a Christian, for somebody that should have been a Christian, for somebody that was called to be a Christian that at one time was. Praise God. Having a golden cup in her hand full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. Okay, there's that fornication coming in here again. And upon her forehead, okay, was the name written, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots. Okay, and this is harlot church. You see, this is on this woman's forehead. Talk about 666. Talk about a mark being put on their forehead or hands. See, the Bible's always talking about this forehead. And it means the way they think, the way they function. The hand means if there's a mark there, that's the things they do. Okay? So the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And I saw her and I wondered with great admiration. Now, every Pentecostal church I've been in that reads out of Revelation tests 100% tell you that's a Roman Catholic church. Look what they did back in the day. Look at how evil they were. Okay, Babylon the Great, the mother. It says this beast has the mother of harlots. Okay, so there's a mother. If you want to say that's the Catholic Church, they are a perfect example of this thing functioning. They're part of it, but there's more because it says she's the mother of harlots. That's plural. Okay, so who are these harlots it's talking about? We're going to find out. And the woman which thou sawest is that great city, it says further down in Revelation 18, okay, which reigneth over the kings of the earth, okay? You're going to find out this is Babylon the Great, okay, this great city. And let's read this in Daniel 9:26. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince that shall come, that's Jesus, the people of the prince that shall come, shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolations are determined. And it told you that flood when it talks about the swelling of Jordan and the river overflowing, and Revelation where it talks about that the dragon spewed forth water as a flood to get the woman. You know, it's talking about armies. It's talking about wicked nations coming in over the land like a flood and doing what they do. Okay? But now, let's look at this. And the people of the prince, and it just got done talking about the Messiah prince, okay? In the verse before this in Daniel, before I started, it's talking about Messiah being the prince, okay? The prince of peace, okay? It says that, and the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. So what's that saying? It's saying people, Christians, are going to destroy the outer court and the sanctuary. And you know that. The outer court, the holy place, and the holy of holies. That's all Old Testament. But it gave us an understanding and typology of the different levels in Christianity, the different maturities that are out there. I got a chart, I'll paste it. You just got to study this stuff. But these people are going to come. It talks about that the outer court shall be trampled upon for 42 months. But it talks about even the sanctuary be trodden over, okay? So God's going to, that woman that it talks about in Revelation 12, this is the place even where the two virgins are at in Matthew 25, what is it, 7? Where, you know, it says that at midnight the cry was made, behold, the bridegroom cometh, and they were all slumbering and sleeping. They had to wake up and come out of that place they were in. Okay, there was a trimming of their lamps that had to take place. Isaiah 66 talks about the travail, you know. There's things that aren't going to be good that have to start to shake the church from the place she's in. And because there's mixture, there's tares within the midst. And the Lord has to now separate them at this point. So, praise God. So after God separates them, he's going to bring forth his power. So, you know, I'm just trying to show you that this woman that's riding the beast, she's called that great city. And again, it talks about here in Daniel 9:26 that the people or the prince that shall come shall destroy the city. Okay, that's what we're seeing here. Put this stuff together, brethren. Okay, so now let's look into what the Bible says about whores, about fornication, and about adultery. This is in 1 Kings. Some of these passages are going to be long here, but I really want you to get the understanding here. It says, then, this is 1 Kings 3, 16 through 21. Then came there two women that were harlots, okay, unto the king, and stood before him. And the one woman said, O my Lord, I and this woman dwell in one house, okay, it's the household of God. And I was delivered of a child with her in the house. And it came to pass the third day after that I was delivered, that this woman was delivered also. Now they twisted that around actually, but in the Hebrew this is what it actually said. And it happened on the third day after I brought forth, this woman also delivered. Okay, so it's talking about a third day thing here, and you're going to find out what that is. It's all pointing to the end time. And there's these two women in the same house. Again, this is your wise and your foolish virgin. Okay. And we were together, and there was no stranger in the house with us, save we two in the house. Now that's saying two things. That's like you're presenting your case before, well, the king here, but we would go before a judge. And she's trying to establish this woman, this harlot. She's trying to establish. Nobody else was in this house. It was just us two. And something bad happened, so one of us had to have done it. Okay? And these two are typing out as the wise and the foolish. This is not a secular force coming and doing this, brethren. This isn't sinners. This is what happens in the household of God. Okay. And there was no stranger with us in the house, save we two in the house. And this woman's child died in the night because she overlaid it. Okay? That's talking about her covering over it, not the Holy Spirit. And she arose at midnight and took my son from beside me. Okay? What did the foolish say to the wise? Give us your oil. Okay? Our lamps have gone out. This is where this correlates. Okay? It's Matthew 25:8. Okay, so she took my son from beside me while the handmaid slept. Okay, that's Matthew 25:5, you know, that they all slumbered and slept. Okay, and laid it in her bosom, and laid her dead child in my bosom. And when I rose in the morning to give my child suck, behold, it was dead. But when I considered it in the morning, behold, it was not my son which I did bear. Okay, that's Isaiah 66:7, 8, you know, that nation that shall be born in one day. So, This is showing you all typology again here. Why does it mention the third day? Why are these stories even put in the Bible, brethren? You got to look at this. These two women. But look at, they're both called harlots. And you're going to see that. You're going to see that it's very easy to commit harlotry, adultery, in the dispensation of grace. Because what did Jesus say? If you even look at a woman to lust after her, you've committed adultery in your heart. And that's why don't get so offended when you hear these terms. Oh, that would never be me. We aren't that hard of a church. Oh my gosh. No, you are. And you're going to find this out, you know. Just take correction when it comes and repent and praise God. Don't want to be like Satan, okay? Now let's look at this in John 2, 1 through 2. And the third day, now this again, this is typology, but it was like Jesus' third day in Galilee. There was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there, and both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. Okay, this is the thing talked about in Matthew 25. Behold, the bridegroom cometh, and then they, you know, they rose, and the foolish had to go out looking for oil, and then it said the bridegroom came, and those that were ready went in. Okay, this is symbolic rendering of that, a synopsis of that situation in Matthew 25. Okay. And it says now this third day, and I'm going to have to get in what this means, because you might say, well, that's going to be during the seventh millennium, but it's not, because there's different ways to number things in God's Word. It's through, then you understand the chronology of when the timing is. That's why this is a thing I studied, and I'm trying to give this to you. Okay, let's look in John 7:14. And this is the story where Jesus was there at his house, and there was a feast. There was a Feast of Tabernacles, and that's a seven-day-long feast. And there's a reason for that. And he, his brethren were going to go up to the feast, and they said, come on up with us. And he says, you know, they said, any man who wants to be known doesn't hide himself. He should go up there. And Jesus says, oh no, my time is not yet full come, but yours is always ready. You go. He said, I don't go to this feast yet. Okay? But then what does it say? It says, but then after his brethren left, then Jesus went up to the feast, not openly, but as it were in secret. Okay, that's a type of the secret coming that happens right at the beginning of the Great Tribulation. Another teaching, but I'm trying to give you things so that it starts to click here. Okay, so this is John. This is what I was just telling you. Now, this is what happened when Jesus got to this feast. It says in John 7:14, now about the midst of the feast, and it was the Feast of Tabernacles at that time, Jesus went up into the temple and taught. So Jesus came in the midst of the feast, okay? That was in the middle of the week. It was a seven-day-long feast. So he came 3.5 days later into the midst. Now, that's what Daniel, is it 9 talks about? I think we'll get in. Guess we won't. It talks about that how that Messiah was cut off in the midst. It's talking about Daniel's 70th week and the prophecy in Jeremiah 25. And it talks about 70 years in Babylon. And then Daniel says that I learned through the study of books and stuff. I came to this understanding. I thought I had that in there. I must have left that out. Well, I can find it. I'll paste in a picture here, a chart that shows this. But it basically shows that the 70th week of Daniel was his last week. It was a prophetic week, okay? 7-day long week, but yet each day was supposed to be accounted as a year. So we're actually talking about 7 years at the end of this prophecy. And what happened was Jesus already ministered for 3.5 years of that prophetic week. And what happens is that it's just shown like this in John 7:14, that in the midst of the feast, which was the Feast of Tabernacles, which we know is the last prophetic, symbolic feast to come forth, because we've already had Passover and Pentecost, and now we're going to have Tabernacles. Those are the three great feasts. And the Tabernacles is where God says He will come and dwell with us, okay? And we will be His people, and we will know Him as He knows us. It's talking about the dispensation of the fullness, brethren. It's something that we really haven't had yet. We've had a taste. It talks about that we've had the earnest. Given to us right now, but yet there's a fullness coming. And so when Jesus was cut off in the midst of that feast, not for himself, but for the people to come, so this, the two witnesses, the man-child, the overcomers, the 144,000, Gideon's 300, all these different symbolic titles and labels that are put on who's going to be given this power, okay? They come back, they start where Jesus left off. But what happens in chronology, why this is so confusing for so many people, is that 2,000 years ago, Jesus ministered for 3.5 years, and then he was cut off, it said, but not for himself, for the people to come. And now when other people are going to start where he left off and finish that 70th week, finish that last 3.5 years, which makes up the full week, okay? But there's a 2,000-year gap in between. Right now it's about 2,000... how many years? Because the calendar's off by 48 years. So it's 2017 right now, okay? And Jesus, it says, all the verses that talk about him having to tarry and delay his coming, it talks about the Good Samaritan, that here's 2 pence, they represent 2,000 years. And he said, if it takes more, when I come back, I'll give you that too. So We're in a place, brethren, of delay and tarrying right now, and we just read that. Why the shower? We're going to read it here too. Why? Because Jesus can't come and give us the full power yet, because we're still in a bad place. He's trying to bring correction, but there's going to come a point in time where he says, enough, I'm going with what I have. And we're fast approaching that, brethren. So, Jesus being cut off in the midst for the people to come, this is what this whole story in John 7 is showing you in type, that he returns secretly in the midst of the feast. So Jesus comes back in the spirit, Christ comes back to fill his people with the double portion, the same place he left off. It's just that there was this gap for the Gentiles in between. Until the fullness of the Gentiles comes in, the Jews have been blinded, it says. So now he's going to unblind them at the end of this time, and he's going to give his power to the two witness group, and they're going to start to minister to the Jews again and fulfill the last half of that 70th week. So, that's all that. Let's go into this now here in Jeremiah 3. This is a long passage, and I'll try not to interrupt too much. But again, these two harlots, you'll see that one of them was good. Actually, the one that brought forth, okay? She brought forth, she said, you know, it was not my child. So there was a living child and there was a dead child. You see, there's a living church right now and there's a dead church. They're not bringing forth fruit. They're not bringing forth the life of God. They're bringing forth systems and psychology and all the stuff that's not from God. Don't be offended when God's even calling his people a harlot. Even the good ones, he talks about figs, some good, some naughty. But both of those figs in that basket, it talks about, had to be carried away into Babylon for their own good. Praise God. It talks about the three Hebrews who were overcomers, a type of the remnant, and yet they were thrown in a furnace seven times hotter because they still had bondages that had to be burnt off. This is all there, brother. Sometimes God uses the severity of terms to really, you know, shock us, wake us up. Oh my gosh, that's how God thinks of me? Exactly. So this is in Jeremiah 3, verses 1 through 10. They say, if a man put away his wife, and she go from him and become another man's, shall he return unto her again? Shall that land be greatly polluted? But thou hast played the harlot with many lovers. Okay, now this is how God sees some people in his church, in his body. But thou hast played the harlot with many lovers. Yet return again to me, saith the Lord. Lift up thy eyes onto the high place, and see where thou hast not been lying with. In the ways thou, excuse me, in the way hast thou sat for them, as the Arabian in the wilderness, and thou hast polluted the land with thy whoredoms and with thy wickedness. Therefore, now we're going to start here. Therefore, something's been withheld. Why? Because God says you're off committing adultery and fornication and doing all this wicked stuff. Okay? Therefore, the showers have been withholden, and there has been no latter rain. Okay? This is why the nations haven't fallen yet. I'm just going to interject this before we go any further. Why have these things been withholden? The latter rain, the former and the latter rain, the double portion, the greater works ministry. Why haven't we seen the sons of God come forth yet? The two witness ministry, the man child. Why? Because the Lord's delaying. Why? Okay, let's read this in Isaiah 26:18. We have been with child. We have been in pain. We have, as it were, brought forth wind. We have not wrought any deliverance in the earth, neither have the inhabitants of the world fallen. And that's Isaiah 26:18. Okay? They're admitting a fact, and this is during what's right before the indignation starts. And Isaiah 26:20 talks about, come, my people, hide thyself till the indignation be overpassed. For the Lord himself shall rise and shake terribly the earth and all this stuff, okay? These Christians are crying out. We've been in pain. Going to bring forth, you know. It's again, the church always keeps bringing forth and coming up into a higher place. But this end time, last day, Laodicean church just couldn't produce. And so God has to bring some tribulation into her life. And God says, this is why you haven't got the latter rain or the former rain, because you're off committing spiritual adultery and harlotry against me. Okay? Let's read this. Therefore, the showers have been withholden, and there have been no latter rain, and thou hast a whore's forehead. Wow, you know he's talking to his church. He's talking to the people he wants to give the form and the latter rain to. All you scholars should understand, that's Christians. That's end time Christians that are in a good place, and God wants to give it. And yet he says you have a whore's forehead. What is that? Okay, you're thinking like a whore. You're off committing the spiritual adultery against me. Okay, and he gets into this. Thou refusest to be ashamed. Will thou not from this time cry unto me, my father, thou art my guide of my youth? Will he reserve his anger forever? Will he keep it to the end? Behold, thou hast spoken and done evil things as thou couldest. The Lord said also unto me in the days of Josiah the king, hast thou seen that which backslidden Israel has done? She has gone up upon every high mountain and under every green tree, and there played the harlot. And I said, after she had done all these things, turn thou unto me. But she returned not, and her treacherous sister Judah saw it. And I saw, when for all the causes whereby backslidden Israel committed adultery, I had put her away, and given her a bill of divorcement, yet her treacherous sister Judah feared not, and went and played the harlot also. Okay. See how this goes on? And it came to pass, through the lightness of her whoredoms, I mean, she just didn't think this stuff was no big deal, that she defiled the land and committed adultery with stones and with stocks. Now, how do you do that? Okay, we're talking spiritual adultery here. And yet, for all this, her treacherous sister Judah had not turned unto me with her whole heart, but frainly, okay, saith the Lord. That's Jeremiah 3, 1 through 10. And you always see that Judah and Israel type out, again, like the wise and the foolish virgins. And even Judah went, and for all the things that she saw that weren't being done right by those outer court churches, and this is why I say, I sat under this teaching. I sat under people who knew about the fivefold ministry, who fully understood what outer court churches are, and what that meant, and how they're going to get trampled. They're not going to be raptured away. There's going to be a judgment coming first to the household of God. Okay, they believed that. They saw that. But you know what? They started moving under that same power structure. They started being in a place where you couldn't do anything unless they first prayed about it and then would tell you if you could do it or not. You couldn't go do minister to anybody or go share it unless they really felt it was the Lord. They always wait on the Lord, wait on the Lord, wait on the Lord. You know, you got to hear from God. You got to do this. You got to do that. It was this place again where they were usurping the place of the Holy Spirit in the midst instead of letting the freedom and the liberty come forth in God. There's to be a true submitting one to another. There's to be a right place of recognizing, you know, those who are worthy of double honor, it says. But it's not through a spirit of control. It's not through respect of persons. And that's why Judah's being judged, because she goes and starts to do the same thing. Okay, this is why the three Hebrews were thrown in the furnace. This is why even the wise virgin was slumbering and needed to wake up and shake herself and go out and trim her lamp. Okay, not in a good place. Nobody is. Okay, so let's read this thing here about the former and the latter rain again. And it's, well, we read that about her being in pain and not bringing anything forth. Okay, so now I want to show you another harlot in the house of God. Okay, another, well, whoremonger. And it talks about Revelation that whoremongers and liars and adulterers and all these people are going to have their place in the lake of fire. Okay, then Samson went to Gaza and saw there a harlot and went in and in onto her. Okay, this is Judges 16:1. You read about Samson, he liked to mess around with whores. He liked to go down to the harlot's house and have himself a good time, you know. That's how he even hooked up with Delilah. So, again, a great man of God, you know, did a lot of things, and yet he was in this place of compromise, just like Solomon. You know, that's amazing, isn't it? Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived. This place he had with God, and yet what does it say also in his life? That he had 1,000 wives, okay? He had all these concubines. I think he had 700 wives and 300 concubines. It says he started going into the pagans' temples and worshiping the god Astra. You know, that's talking about the orgies and sexual fornication and all this stuff. Solomon, okay? So how the mighty have fallen, it talks about. My gosh. Anyway, let's read about another harlot in Genesis 38:15. When Judah saw her, he thought her to be a harlot. No, this is his sister-in-law again with his son that died. God kept smiting them because they weren't in a good place. And so he was supposed to take care of his wife and his son's wife and get her another husband, but he wouldn't. So she pulled something on him. But when Judah saw her, he thought her to be a harlot because she had covered her face. And he turned onto her by the way and said, "Go to, I pray thee, let me come in unto thee." For he knew not that she was his daughter-in-law. And she saith, "What wilt thou give me?" Okay, that's Genesis 38, 15, 16. But here again, here's another man of God that wants to go in and commit adultery. Wants to go in and you know, be with a harlot. That's what he thought. So this is the spirit that's in the church, brethren. It was in naturally in the Old Testament, and it's here spiritually right now during the New Testament. There's, you know, the obvious things are, like I've shared this before, the promise keepers. I heard this on Christian radio. They said that when promise keepers comes into a town, that the pornography sales just go through the roof. They skyrocket. That these pastors and these, quote, men of God are buying up more pornography than the sinners do on any given day. Okay? So there's things that are hid that yet when you hear it, it's like, oh my gosh, of course, these people are wicked. But if they don't repent, it's not going to be good. But there's other things that you wouldn't see as wicked, but it is. It's a structure outside of God's structure. And he's trying to show you this. So praise God. Now there's a thing here in Daniel 8:13, and it says, "Then I heard one saint speaking to another saint, said unto that certain saint which spake, How long shall be the vision concerning the daily sacrifice and the transgression of desolation, to give both the sanctuary and the host to be trodden underfoot?" Okay? So that's that place again of the outer court and the holy place, that there's things in the household of God, brethren. That's why the nations haven't fallen yet. That's why all we've brought forth is wind, as it were. Sure, there's people getting saved here and there. Sure, there's great men of, excuse me, God that I see on videos and things that are doing marvelous things in the name of Jesus, you know, through His Spirit. Marvelous things, marvelous. But the world hasn't been turned upside down yet, brethren. That's what God's going for. His kingdom's got to come to this earth. It's never going to be accomplished by this little speck happening here and that little speck happening here and this little speck happening. God has to bring forth His power in its fullness. And that's what we need to come into. So He's going to come back and He's going to allow, that's what midnight's all about. He's going to allow Gog to come and tribulate His church. It's what He's always had to do to the Jews all throughout the centuries. When they backslid, when they turned from God, He would allow wicked nations come, capture them, sack them, burn their city, tear down Jerusalem, whatever it took, drive the people off, until they came into a place of repentance. And yet there's always hope, brethren, so this is what I want to show you. There's always hope if you can repent. But as soon, now this, we know this story about the son here that took the money and went off living foolishly. It says, "But as soon as thy son was come, which has devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. And he said unto him, Son, thou art with me, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad. For this thy brother was dead and is alive again, was lost and is found." Okay, that's Luke 15:30-32. Praise God. Now it's talking about this brother was dead and he's alive again. He was lost, but now he's found. Okay, this brother was in a good place before that. He was saved. Okay? But it talks about neglecting your salvation. It talks about forsaking your salvation. It talks about, you know, basically rejecting the things of God. And a citizen said, sent a messenger after him and said, "We will not have this man to rule over us." Okay? You're not seeing that done in the natural. That's a spiritual thing that's happening in brethren's hearts. They're saying that every time they know that what they're doing isn't the Word of God. They're saying that every time they sit in front of one of these stupid wicked sitcoms that is promoting, you know, homosexuality, that's promoting all these things that's normal and good and acceptable. But in God's eyes, it's definitely not, because that is not how God created His creation to be. But, you see, I see Christians all the time that watch this stuff, gawk it up, laugh, oh, and all these things that are going on. It's God's going to judge for that, brethren. There's going to be no escaping that. But if they repent, then they won't be lost anymore, and they won't be dead anymore. He'll bring them back to life, okay? So I just want to end the study. I don't know if I presented it the way I should, if I've got out what I needed to get out, but I'm just... These are things God has shown me for years. I'll tell you what, brethren, I started off as a Catholic, like I said, 27 years. I got saved. I went into what you would call milkwater churches, okay? They just operated at a very low level with what they taught, with how they functioned. But that's, you know, that's what I went into. I learned a lot of false things. And then I started moving up. I started going into, I went into a Baptist church then, okay? And then I started hearing this and that, and I started to see things, but they only got to a level and they stopped, you know? It's like every day, every week, somebody who just stood up and, I'm born again now, I'm saved. It's like, you know, the next week he'd stand up and say, no, I'm really saved now, I'm really saved. I know every week this would go on. I was like, this is insane, what's going on here? Okay, then I got into some Pentecostal churches, and I started seeing the gifts of the Spirit. I started seeing things move as they should, but yet I saw them stuck at a certain level. And that focus around some little pet doctrine, whether it was talking in tongues or whatever it was, they stick on that. But it was, all of them were still operating in this clergy laity structure. Okay. Then I moved out of that, and God started calling me into what you call a fellowship. And I started fellowshipping with brethren. And, you know, they knew that denominations were wrong. They knew, you know, it talks about the church in Corinth. The church here, the church here. Well, we had a name, and it was basically the city we lived in, you know. And that's just, we gave ourselves a name. That's what we had to have. So the church in so-and-so. And, but I saw even that corruption come into the midst of that situation. And, you know, they kicked me out with a certified letter in the end. But praise God, because I challenged them. And the very word they had been teaching me and feeding me, kind of like Eli and Samuel, I think it was, the very thing they had been teaching me, I called them to task on. I said, brethren, this is what the word says. You know, if any man comes and he has aught, and this brother won't receive, you know, he needs to take two or three more witnesses. And if he still won't receive it, then you're to bring it to the church. Well, you know, try and follow that function sometime and see where it gets you. So anyway, praise God. I hope this was a blessing. Again, I'm not trying to bring forth condemnation. I've been there and done that. The very thing I'm telling you about, I have operated in, I have moved in, I believe was the truth. And yet, God kept bringing me out, calling me out, calling me into a better place. And I know there's still things He's got to get out of me, still things He's going to yet call out of me. I know that. It says Jesus had to learn obedience through the things He suffered. Okay? We're going to come into a suffering, especially in this country in America, that we've never seen yet. You know, there's brethren in Korea and Iran, a lot of Muslim nations who are, you know, if you support or read anything from Voices of the Martyrs, you're going to find out what true Christianity will cost you. So, and I'll tell you what, they're not being raptured. Praise God. So, I just want to end this study and thank you for watching again, and bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.